but this is a collective machinery which is global now. There are people from all over the world working together to test the laws against nature, basically what you said, discovering the Big Bang thing and now the Higgs boson and studying the Higgs boson. And I want to show you that this collective machinery could be a model for the society today, because obviously this is for basic knowledge, which is a common good, but there are now challenges for many common goods, global common goods, like climate, biodiversity, water, and so on. And this might be an inspiring model, it might be inspiring to get people working together from all over the world with different religions, culture, and so on, but sharing a common ideal towards knowledge for science. So, machinery to test laws against nature. So I know that in this audience, there are people who know better than me what this means, but I want to remind you what I mean by that. So what kind of laws and what do you mean against nature? So at CERN, we are trying to understand the ultimate constituents of particles for now, which is the theory of relativistic quantum field theory, which we call the standard model of particles and fields. So it's really a new level of knowledge which has been achieved with these discoveries, not only in terms of particles, but in terms of laws. In fact, all these particles and interaction can be described with one equation. By the way, you saw that I did not mention gravity. Gravity is still escaping this understanding, this basic understanding. So in fact, you have two basic equations in physics now. One which is this one, to describe the behavior of the elementary particles through their interactions, strong interaction, electromagnetic interaction. And there is another equation, which is the Einstein equation of general relativity, to describe gravitation. This is the level of knowledge where we are. Two basic equations which are not possible to unify so far, and this is where we are. In fact, you can see that with this equation, we are achieving a goal which was a dream of physicists and which is favored by cosmology, which means that the deeper we go into nature, so the higher energy you reach, because higher energy means probing smaller distances, the higher energy you go, the more unified picture you get. You remember that magnetism and electricity were two different forces and they were unified with the electromagnetism equations by Maxwell. Then, with the recent advent of LEP and then LHC, we have a unification of electromagnetism and weak interaction. So this is the electrogroup model, this is what I am referring to, this standard model of particles and fields, electrogroup model, together with the QCD, which describes the strong nuclear equation, the strong nuclear force. In fact, the equation that I showed was describing the electronic model, which added also the strong nuclear force. Maybe one day we will unify, we are trying to do that with LHC, but apparently this is not yet successful. We hope very much to unify QCD and electronic model with a grand unification, which would imply probably the supersymmetry, but which has not yet been discovered. But gravity is still separate. There was an unification with Newton of terrestrial gravity and celestial gravity. Then, after Newton, Einstein came with this unification of gravitation and mass, which are distorting the space and time. This is the deterministic approach, geometrical approach to gravity, while this is quantum and probabilistic. This is gravitation is deterministic and geometric. And the unification of gravity with the rest is still a challenge, both theoretical and experimental. So this gives you the picture, the flavor of what CERN is doing, trying to test the laws and ideas against nature. How we do that? We do that experimentally. It's quite heavy. You can see the machinery which is behind that. It's a big accelerator, which is called the LHC, with which the Higgs boson and the Broughton belt and its mechanism were discovered. It's a 27-kilometer circumference accelerator. It is underground, 100 meters underground. So you see here in yellow the image on the ground of this machine, which is not visible because it is underground, 27 kilometers. It's a tunnel where there is a big tank for cryogeny in order to cool the accelerator of the magnets at 1.9 K. This is cooled with a super helium, super speed helium. The magnets which keep the proton on this circle are superconducting magnets, so 27 kilometers of superfluid helium and magnets in order to keep the protons in this circumference. The protons go in one direction and in the other direction, and they collide at four, uh, four places in which you want to be new. So you can see that this is an exceptional site, 27 kilometer circumference machine. Here you can see the white mountain, the Mont Blanc, the Lemon Lake. This is the Jura. This is Geneva, which is over there. You can see the spring here. It crosses the border between Switzerland and France. This is in white. So it was a long-term, really a long-term adventure. In fact, the idea of the Higgs boson came around 64. The idea that the machine could be built to discover, discover or to exclude the Higgs boson and both interacting Higgs mechanism came in 1984. The machine was approved in 1994. The first collisions were in 2010. The Higgs boson discovery is in 2012. Was in 2012. And we plan to study with the LHC the Higgs mechanism and the Higgs boson and the electronic interactions till 2035. So you see, it's a 60 years long adventure. So again, when you think of long-term challenges, this gives you an idea of what CERN can achieve over 50 years. Now, it's a very big machine. The laboratory, the CERN laboratory is here. It is the CERN laboratory which built this machine and which allowed to enter a new era for basic sciences. But the experiments were built by collaborations of a few thousand people, 3,000 people for Atlas, 3,000 people for CMS, a little less for LHCb, and for ELIS. These are the four big experiments which are built by the community. So it is, we are used to say that this ring is the Lord of the Rings, 27 kilometers, but these collaborations, these are the fellowship of the ring, which built together this big detector. This detector really, the size of the classic world, you can see one person here can barely see it. So small compared to the size of the detector. There are about 70 countries participating to this adventure. So 70 countries, all the countries, which we do not today. About in total 12,000 researchers and a few hundred laboratories. So there are 10 to the 15 protons circulating in one direction and in the other direction, and you have about 1 million collisions per second. So the beam lasts for about 1 day, and it has to be refilled every day. And you get the collisions which look like that. These were the first collisions in CMS. These are Z collisions, because you can also accelerate Z nuclei and reproduce Big Bang in the laboratory. So I come now to describe a bit more detail what is the CERN. As I said, it is both a laboratory located in Geneva with about 3,000 people, staff people, but it is also a fellowship, a community of 12,000 researchers all over the world using this CERN infrastructure. The mission of CERN was created in 1954. It is by a treaty between the countries. A treaty, so this is what also what probably will be for the global public good. The mission of CERN are stated in the convention. The convention mentioned four missions: push forward the frontiers of knowledge. What was the matter like within the first moment of the universe existence, because as I said, with this big collision, with this high energy collision, you are reproducing mini big bangs. Develop new technologies for accelerator and detector. I mentioned magnets, superfluid cooling, and so on. Train scientists and engineers of tomorrow, and unite people from different countries and cultures. This is what I said. 70 countries which are participating to this adventure. In fact, here you have a map of the connection of the world to CERN. In white, these are the countries which are not connected at all with CERN. In red, these are countries which are connected at CERN by bringing pieces of equipment for the big detectors that I showed, Atlas, Flinders, and CERN. And they have cooperation agreement. In red, in green, these are countries which are which not only contributed to the detector, but also contributed to the machine, to energy. And for this, they are considered an observer to the CERN Council. In the light blue, these are associate members, which contribute 10% of what they would contribute to the common pot if they were full members. And in dark blue, these are clearly the member state countries, which contribute to the CERN budget in a common pot and participate fully to the CERN Council and take the decisions for the long-term vision and the budget of CERN year after year. So you can see the member states and the number of people, but by the way, you can see that the US has more physicists participating to CERN than any of the member state countries, which shows you that really this is a global adventure. CERN is already a model for similar scientific adventure. For instance, in Dubna, the Joint Institute for Nuclear Research, the former USSR countries joined together to form JNR on the CERN model. Cesame, which is a synchrotron machine in the Middle East, in Jordan, where you get all the Middle East countries, including Israel, Iran, Palestine, Authority, and other countries, Turkey, Pakistan. They are working together with the convention, which is copied from CERN, and maybe an African light source could be also copied on this one. This is not only science, but as I said, you could get inspiration for other global challenges. So at CERN, there are 3,000 paid personnel by the common pot from CERN. But there are 12,000 scientific users coming from all these countries, paid by their home institution. The budget of the CERN laboratory is about 1 billion euro per year. But in addition, you have the budget to build the detectors coming from all these countries. So in some sense, I already showed you that you have a combination of two organizations. One which is the CERN laboratory, which basically builds the machine, and the other one are the big collaborations. And these are two types of management. One, which is more standard, which is the CERN International Organization, CERN Laboratory, which is, in some sense, a little bit top-down. So the leaders are designated by the CERN Council. So you have the CERN Council with the member states. They designate the director general, the director general as an executive, staff, which is dispatching departments. So I would say this is a little bit top-down. You have a finance committee, a scientific policy committee, which is based on merits. So this is one type of organization. And the other type of organization, these are the collaborations, for the Atlas. There you have 3,000 scientists. There is a light memorandum of understanding between the laboratories. There is a constitution, which is adopted by the 3,000 scientists. All leaders are elected. This is a kind of peer recognition. So you could say this is bottom. It's a self-organized and peer merit recognition. And you can see here, this was in 2003. You can see here, for instance, for the physics coordination, it was Fabiola Giannetti. So this is the source of new leaders. In fact, Fabiola Giannetti now is director general of the CERN laboratory. So you see a mixture of top-down and bottom-up. The CERN laboratory is a little bit the conductor of all these collaborations. It plays the role of a conductor of an orchestra. The orchestra is the big collaborations. The big collaborations are bottom-up, and the conductor, the conductor laboratory, mortal data. Again, this is a model which could be inspiring for, for climate and associated citizens, all initiatives, bottom up. But you need an organization to conduct in a coherent way of this. So I don't say that this should be copied, but the idea of marrying a top-down organization, international organization, with a bottom-up citizens organized, I think this is a good concept. So this is for Atlas. Now, what is also interesting is that, so this is a complex system, so you see all the accelerators, these big collaborations. In fact, it's not only researchers. All tools, all skills are needed to build both the accelerators and the detectors. You can see that from, for instance, the accelerators, you need a cryogenic, I told you about a superfluidium, you need a magnet experts, electrotechnical experts, you need high precision mechanics because you have alignment within a few microns. You need for the detectors a wide variety of detectors. For instance, you can see here crystals, pixel detectors, calorimeters, gas chambers, signal trackers, and so on. So a variety of skills which are needed to orchestrate, to assemble, in order to get these detectors and machines constructed. And again, this is what you need for most global challenges, all skills from them. And last but not least, the computing was a real challenge. In fact, not a single computer with all the data which are taken, but we told you about 1 billion collisions per second, and each detector is many million pixels, so this is a huge number of bits per second. So what was implemented was a network, kind of web of computers, network of computers which was acting like a single computer. What we call the grid, which is in some sense the ancestor of the cloud computing. So the data and the computing power are shared between all these computers, which are spread all over the world. So you see all these institutes and users, even the PC, are in the user. By the way, all this is done in a kind of open innovation mode. And this collaborative and open innovation mode led to many successes. And I want to show you a list, which is not exhaustive, of what was invented at CERN and tested for the first time. The first touch panels were in the 70s. The web, I hope that you know that, was born at CERN in the 90s. In fact, we celebrated the 30th anniversary of the birth of the web at CERN very recently, a few years ago. Open source software was very much pushed forward with CERN. Simulations, programs with detector matter and radiation, PET camera, MRI. Now, open innovation, there is a big program which is called ATTRACT, which is financed by the European Union, on open innovation, open access publishing. This is a push by CERN, which was very strong, and which is now a kind of model for the other field of science. Data access, data, open data, I can say that probably astronomers went further than what was implemented. Collaborative tools for project management, agenda. OECD studied this model of CERN and they concluded that the benefit of open innovation for growth in the world is much better with an open moderator than with the standard patterns. So we have already a demonstration by OECD that this model is probably better for growth in the world. So how can you get all these people working together in a coherent matter? This is not easy. You need this bottom-up approach and self-organized collaboration. There is no real hierarchical power. People are dependent on their own lab, and you have to coordinate with these people. And this can only work because they are all animated with the same passion and the same ideas. So this is again what I said. This could work for common, for global public good, for example, for climate. We all want to succeed to avoid global warming. So in some sense, you can use this also to get people working together. But without this common idea and passion, this could not work. Now I come to the discovery quickly. So you see here François Langlais and Peter Hees. This happened on July 4th, 2012. There was a conference, a press conference, and we were surprised that this was covered all over the world beyond our expectations. In fact, in TVs, in the newspaper, it was after the event, we learned that about 1 billion people, were exposed to the discovery and knew about the things to discover. So how they could understand what it means, this was a little bit of a mystery because it is quite abstract and it is very, I cannot to explain it even to you in a few minutes. But the fact that this was a new continent of knowledge which was explored, a new limit of knowledge which was explored, a little bit like the discovery of a new continent, and that this was a step for mankind. So we tried to explain what it meant, what it meant. So in fact, this is one of the, among the billion of collisions, one of the collisions where possibly Higgs boson was produced and decaying into two photons. These are the green tracks here. In fact, this was seen with a mass spectrum distribution. So here you see the mass of hypothetic parametric particles which could be at the origin of these two photons. This is the distribution. There are many events with two photons. And when you look at the distribution of the mass of the two photons, you get a continuous curve, which is well described by the standard model, plus a peak. And the peak is also well described by the standard model, provided that this peak is due to the Higgs boson decaying into the two photons. So this was already an indication. This was seen by two experiments. It was also seen in another channel with four cracks, electrons and muons. So two channels and two experiments. This was enough to claim that the CERN experiments observed these light particles. Okay, this is a bulb. So why is it so important to such a bulb in an histogram? This is because we thought that this was a Higgs boson. And the Higgs boson is touching deep understanding of the origin of mass of particles. In fact, this has to do with quantum fluctuations in the vacuum fluctuation. The vacuum in quantum mechanics is full of virtual particles. And the virtual particles connected to the Higgs boson give to the vacuum a kind of viscosity. And this is this viscosity which is at the origin of the mass of the electrons and the other particles. We knew from the theory that if this Higgs mechanism and the Higgs particle was existing, it should have a mass less than 1 TeV, and this is why the LHC, which accelerate protons at 7 TeV against 7 TeV, we were sure that the LHC could answer the question whether the Higgs exist or not. This has to do with quantum symmetry breaking in the vacuum. So this is a kind of phase transition of the quantum vacuum, which is at the origin of the mass of particles. In fact, at very high energy, we think that this viscosity is null, and particles are massless. Big bang energies, particles are massless. And when the universe cools down, you get a kind of phase transition when the temperature is bounded with the energy of the Vinci, so few hundred GV. When the temperature went down, down a few hundred GV, so the physical condition in the vacuum, a little bit like the superconductivity, where you get this viscosity induced by the virtual heat factors. Later on, this was confirmed, in particular for the channel with four electrons or four muons or two electrons, two muons. And this was confirmed. So now we are sure that we are dealing with the X particle and the X mechanism. There are many channels in which the X boson is observed, and we want to go to more and more accuracy, precision, for understanding the behavior of this new particle. In fact, you see a function of time, so I told you that we think that energy will run 37. We are here about the year 90, so there is a big down now. We are reaching, this is not needed, this is the number of collisions. So we are here, and at the end we will be here. So we will have 20 times more collisions in 37, so much better records. It's time now to already discuss what could be the next machine after the C. Because if we want to have the next machine by 2040, I told you that it took 20 years or 30 years to build the energy, it would be nice to have an idea of where we go after the energy. And the main trend, I cannot guarantee that this is what we call it, the main trend is, sometimes it's not original, is to have again a bigger machine where the energy could be an injector. So a machine with 100 km circumference going passing below the main neck, around the salive, and the tangent to the jugular. 100 km, this could start with an E plus minus machine collisions studying more detail the heat, the electronic symmetry breaking, this heat mechanism. And so this could be between 2040 and 2055. Then the proton-proton machine again, like it was for LHC, before LHC it was an E plus minus machine, LED, which was transformed into LHC at the end of the 2000. So in 2060, it could be a proton-proton machine with an energy which is 10 times the LHC machine. So this is the idea, to have a 100 km ring, starting with E plus minus for precision measurements, and then proton-proton with 10 times the energy of LHC for the new discoveries. So again, I want to come back where we are now in physics. I told you this is where we are with the understanding of the strong electromagnetic and weak interactions. One equation, it's Lagrangian, connected to quantum field theory, so quantum probabilistic theory. And as I told you, there is another equation, which is this one, the Einstein gravity, where the curvature of space and time is connected to the distribution of energy in the universe. And this is this curvature, which is at the origin of gravity. So gravity is a pure geometrical interaction. Where are we with this equation? There was a spectacular discovery which was a consequence of this equation, which is also a little bit, it's not the sum model, but there is something similar. You remember probably that 3 years ago, in 2016, there was this discovery of gravitational waves by what we call LIGO-Virgo collaboration. So this is also a collaboration of detectors which are distributed all over the world, antennas, which could detect these waves coming from the collapse of two black holes into a single black hole. Two black holes competing with each other, which collapse to form a single black hole. Now they have three events like that, and they also saw the collapse of two neutron stars into a single black hole. So again, these are about a few thousand people working together, sharing the data. More in the collaboration style than in the CERN style, but it's not to CERN, but for gravitational. You can see, so this is a picture of coalescing black holes, and this is the signal which has seen, and this is the gravitational wave antennas. These are two lasers where you look at the interferences between these two lasers. So this is one example. Another example of the consequences of this Einstein equation is cosmology. Cosmology directly derives from the Einstein equation, and after the Einstein equation was discovered, soon people realized that in fact the universe cannot be static, it should be expanding, and the fact that the universe is expanding was exploited to understand the story of the history of the universe, starting from the Big Bang to now, so very high energy temperature to now 2.7 K temperature. In fact, as you know, how can we see that? That the universe was in the past history denser and hotter. We see that because when you look at the far distant galaxies, they all expand from us. The distance is increasing with time, and they are getting far away, further away from us. And we can go back in the history of the universe because the speed of light is 300,000 km per second. So the further you look at, the earlier you see how the universe was. The further you look at, the earlier the universe, the view of the universe when it was earlier. In fact, when you look at the sun, the light coming from the sun takes about 8 minutes to come to you. So in fact, when you see the sun, you see it as it was 8 minutes ago. When you look at stars in the center of our galaxy, you see the stars as they were 30,000 years ago. And if you look at the distant universe, you can see the universe as it was a few billion years ago. And what you see is that the universe was denser and hotter in the past. And in fact, the maximum distance you can see the universe is when it was about 10,000 K hot. Now, due to the redshift, it is 2.7 K. But you can see a map of the universe when it was after 300,000 years, when it was about 10,000 K. And you can see that it was very, very homogeneous, with very little fluctuations of the order of 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5. And these fluctuations, we think, they are the origin of the structure of the universe that exists today, but they take their source in the quantum fluctuations of the vacuum. They take their source as the vacuum, quantum vacuum fluctuations. This is an image of the Planck, the Planck satellite, which was also a collaboration of physicists from all over the world. And with this image, you can now have a kind of consistent history, including the Brout-Engel-X mechanism of the universe. You start from quantum fluctuations, energy quantum fluctuations. You have first an inflation. Then, after 1 picosecond, you started with a unified picture and massless particles. After 1 picosecond, when the temperature went down to 300 GeV, you get the Brout-Engel-X mechanism after 1 picosecond, where the interactions differentiate and the particles start to have masses. Then, after 1 microsecond, the quarks and gluons form the protons and neutrons. After a few minutes, the protons and neutrons form nuclei. After 400,000 years, the nuclei and the electrons combine into atoms. And this is the moment the universe becomes transparent because the atoms are neutral. And you can see today this image that I showed of the universe when the atoms were formed at around 10 to the 1000 that you have the first stars on the galaxy as well. So we have got now a story of the universe. As I told you, this was confirmed. So as I told you, this was confirmed by the Planck satellite. So in some sense, now you have kind of a full history of the universe from the Big Bang to today. You could say that we understand everything. This is not true. We are still major enigma. When you look at what the universe is made of, you find first that the ordinary matter is accounting only for 0.03% of the stars are accounting only for 0.5% of the mass in the universe. If you add up the gas and helium, you get something like 4%. In fact, you need much more to understand the behavior of the rotation of galaxies and the behavior of galaxies between themselves. You need what we call dark matter, which is accounting for 20%, which is not made of standard atoms that we are made of. So we don't know what is dark matter made of. It cannot be made of hydrogen and helium. It cannot be brown dwarfs or Jupiter-like objects because of the lack of micro-density events. So it must be done of new kind of matter. It could be neutrinos, this is very unlikely now. It could be weakly interacting massive particles, for instance, the lightest supersymmetric particle, or excellence or problems of that. But on top of that, there seems to be a vacuum, dark energy. Maybe this is the remaining vacuum energy after the Big Bang, which seems to account for 75% of the energy in the universe. So we are far from having solved everything in nature. There are still laws to be discovered and to be tested against nature. I mentioned here a few of them. First, why this mass is 126 GeV, and that's something else, which is not higher. What is the nature of dark matter? I mentioned that, passing in particles, it seems. What is the nature of dark energy, vacuum energy, or space-time curvature? Where has all the antimatter gone? Because in principle, you would expect that starting from radiation, you would expect to have as much antimatter as matter, so there should be as many stars as anti-stars, and we don't observe any anti-star nor anti-gas. The neutrinos are also a little bit strange particles, enigmatic particles. And finally, to understand what is due to random occurrence or to new laws is still a mystery. There is fine-tuning in the universe itself. So, I come back, and this will be the end of my talk. What did we learn from this machinery, which is CERN? Again, I want to summarize a little bit the machinery, the organization. In some sense, the organization of CERN is a little bit like the energy computing rig that I was discussing when I discussed the computing. The computing at CERN is organized in this way. You have I told you, it's a grid, kind of a web of computers. You have a big center at CERN, which we call the Tier Zero, which is the central node. It is connected to what we call Tier One. So these are a national center. So one in the US, one in France, this is an industry center, one in Italy, one in Canada, so this is in the US as well, and so on. Now these Tier One center are connected to university centers. The university center, this is where the laboratories, particle laboratories are. And then the laboratory center are connected to the PC, individual PC. So you see that you have a conductor, master conductor, which is CERN, but the web is extending till the users. So in some sense, this organization is tier zero, tier one. So tier zero, this is an international organization. And finally, the users at the end are the citizens, intelligence. This is the type of organization that I might invoke, which could serve as a model. You have here the tier zero, which is a little bit top-down, managed by the Sun Council. And then you have the citizens, researchers, which are self-organized. This can work, as I told you, because there are shared values and a common ideal. In fact, the shared values were expressed in the CERN constitution. And if you want to participate to the grid or to participate to the experiment at CERN, to come to CERN, you have to sign up to agree to these values: integrity, commitment, professionalism, creativity, diversity. I think this is a good tool. This was implemented when I was president of the Sun Council, and I think it's worthwhile. So I am trying to plead for this type of organization for other purposes. So we had a workshop with the United Nations. This occurred in 2015. The Sun model, United Nations, and Global Public Group. It was a 2 days workshop, which was quite interesting, and we are trying to pursue these discussions. Now CERN is an observer to the General Assembly of the United Nations, so we try to promote some of them to the United Nations. And also I try to promote it to children, and this is very interesting, to interact with children. I had a chance to go to the to the schools, primary schools, which are distributed around the ring of the LHC, and I could interact with the children, and we asked the children which questions, so they were asking questions. So we selected an ensemble of 50 questions about the universe, matter, and scientists. What is a scientist? They made drawings. So on one page you have a drawing of a child and associated to one question. And on the other page, I tried to make a scientific answer, and there is a rotation of a philosopher or a writer which illustrates the question and the answer. And this has just been published a week ago on the web of CERN. And I will conclude with this. So, as I told you, we are testing nature. We are testing laws against nature. We are approaching now a kind of a scientific cosmogony from the early times of inflation to now. This is a response to a human quest, what matter is made of, where they come from, which is forever, which started still in the beginning of mankind and will probably last till the end of mankind. This is based on a collective rational approach, an open source model. We call this competition because it's a combination of collaboration, but also a strong emulation. You know, the scientists, they want to be sure that they are the best. So there is still a strong emulation between the scientists and very tough discussions. So, but it's also collaboration. We call this competition, which could be a model for global challenges, emulations together. This goes beyond the citizenship or religious particularity, and this is rich of differences. In fact, I think not only we accept diversity, but it's rich of diversity. In fact, you see, in France, there is a school of physics which is more mathematical, in the US, it's more pragmatic. So you add up with the diversity, you add up its richness. It's not just. And I am sure that Africa will bring something else which we could get much more. An interplay between, so this is a question which is seen with us, what the universe is just by chance and what is the law. This is not yet clear. As I said, there is a nest of structures and laws. And there is still a long way to go, so certainly this quest is probably forever. Thank you very much.